Welcome to the WDW News Today podcast. My name is Eric Morton. With me, as always, is Tom Corliss. And today we have a special guest from far away, none other than Dr. Jason Diffendahl. Thank you for joining us, Jason.
Hi, Eric. Thanks. It's great to be here today.
Isn't it? Isn't it always great to be here?
No, it's not always, but today it is.
Special shout out to the WIGS who are watching right now. They watch us live when we do this. Normally this gets released on Tuesdays, but we record it on Fridays or maybe even a week before, like right now. Like,
we had to because Eric and I are going to be on assignment covering the California Food and Wine Festival.
That is
DCA
true.
This weekend, yeah.
Work, work, work.
So, I mean, now this will air after the fact, so if you saw us there, then you saw us there. But if not, you missed us. We were there.
Who doesn't love the DCA Food and Wine Festival?
I used to, the first couple of years, Jason and I used to go.
It used to be fantastic.
The first couple of years, I was so blown away. And then over the years, I'd be like, oh, okay. But that's what happened here, too, right?
Before it kind of jumped the chart.
As this amazing thing. And then a little bit over time, I was like, we'll see. We'll see how it fares.
Yeah, as I recall from last year, number one, it snowed or groppled. Or whatever people said it did.
It snowed.
It snowed. It was very crowded. That day when the festival opened,
yes, it was.
That park gets mobbed and overrun. Yeah. So we're
that's because there's six rides in it.
Yeah,
I mean that aren't carnival ones.
Yeah. Tom, do you want to explain? We've done this before, but I'm told there's a snail behind you. I saw that in the comments.
No, there's no snail behind me. It's Skippy. This is Skippy from Alien Encounter. People have asked, they're like, oh, we know Disney really well. My wife knows Disney really well. We have no idea what's behind you. We film this in our museum, at least as it exists right now. Eventually, when we expand, we're going to have our own podcast studio. So Skippy won't come with us. But
I mean, he could.
He could, but I think he needs to be on display. People love Alien
Encounter. What if I just go get like a snail at a pet store or something and put him on
just have a regular snail?
Yeah,
he could be our mascot, like an actual living snail we take care of.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Skippy the snail.
Skippy the snail.
Yeah, I like this idea. But yeah, Skippy from Alien. There's a bunch of Alien Encounter props and memorabilia behind me because I like Alien Encounter, which I'm excited because several people who worked on Alien Encounter are coming to this building, not for Alien Encounter related festivities, but Stage 89. Several Imagineers who brought Alien Encounter to life will be here, and I can't wait to show them this case of Alien Encounter.
There were some important developments over the weekend. Stage 89, which will be probably old news by the time we air this episode, but you booked a pretty big name.
Yeah, so Bob Weiss, who worked for 35 years at Walt Disney Imagineering and for 6 years of that time was the president of WDI, and then his last year he was a global ambassador, is coming to Stage 89, which was kind of the one big puzzle piece we were missing, which seemed improbable but not impossible as we booked more and more Imagineers, all of them. Like, it was a very tight-knit group, right? Like, we need to establish here. We have done a lot of anniversary events for parks in this company's history and beyond. And it is very rare to get more than one or two or three people that worked on the same thing together in a place for any of these events. This very rarely happens, and so this is pretty wild and special. But they were such a tight-knit group that everyone I called, it was like a pyramid scheme, where they would call two more people that worked with them on the project and be like, do you want these? And I was like, yeah, absolutely. The more people that worked on this park and these attractions, the better. And eventually someone was like, I can reach out to Bob Weiss. Would you like me to do that? I was like, please. For those that don't know, Bob was essentially the creative lead on MGM. Randy Prince, who was essentially his the other side of his brain on that project. Randy was more operations, and but the two of them basically designed and built the park with the team. They're going to give the keynote. So they're going to open up Stage 89 and talk about how it morphed from, because they were there when it was an Epcot pavilion, and they were there when it was just a backstage tour, a studio tour. Then it became a park and a theme park and an active studio, and then, of course, evolved beyond that. So they're going to take us through that whole evolution from Epcot Pavilion all the way through to today, how the park evolved, and I'm sure we'll learn lots of things along the way we did not know, and that's how we're going to open the event. But Bob also was the lead on Tokyo Disneyland and Shanghai Disney, the California Adventure redo that included World of Color and Cars Land. Disney Sea he was involved. I mean, an incredible 35-year career. So he's, you know, that upper echelon with, you know, the likes of Tony Baxter and people like that. Bob might even be a step beyond because none of them were president, right? Marty, you know, think about all the how many WDI or WED presidents there's been, right? And who was before Marty? I don't even remember.
I don't remember either.
Yeah, but Marty Sklar and Bob Weiss being the two most notable.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, yeah, it's super exciting.
Very exciting. Stage89.com. You can still buy tickets. We're also selling streaming tickets, so you can just watch the whole thing unfold. It's going to be first week of May. So it's going to be May.
That weekend. So the streaming ticket works for the first month. They're half off through March 15th only. They're $10. And that will work until June 5th. Is that right?
Yeah.
So you get a whole month that you can watch live and on demand through June 5th. And, the other great thing is it's a nonprofit event for us. We're not making a cent. It all goes to Give Kids the World Village, which is a tremendous cause here in the local area.
Aren't all of our events nonprofit, Tom? I mean, even the ones where we tried to make a profit.
Well, in fairness, all of every anniversary event we've ever done has been nonprofit, right? And with a charity initiative.
Yeah.
You know, then we sell you a plush dinosaur, and that's how we afford to survive.
Oh boy, more stuff to sell. Yeah, Gertie, dinosaur Gertie. I mean,
which might be gone by the time you're watching.
Probably will be gone
by the time this airs. Though they will be gone. We only have a few left.
Yeah,
but you can look on there at wdwnt.link/Gertie.
If they're there, if not, I'm sorry.
If they're there, they're gone. Yeah. If they're gone, we're sorry, but I want to get kind of into this because the reason Jason's here, people will soon figure out, is we're going to talk about the Disney store.
Yeah.
Your memories of it, its new life as it is, and all the things in between. I'm not a person who spent a lot of time at the Disney store. I remember the Disney store. What I can tell you is a lot of these brick-and-mortar retailers got hurt pretty bad. I mean, already there was an evolving, like, online economy.
Yeah.
And then e-commerce, I think, went up something like, I think e-commerce is like $3 trillion economy now. 28% or something like that increase during COVID alone.
Yeah.
And the changing business climate caused them to, unfortunately, close a lot of Disney stores. I think you can get into, like, what the Disney stores had already kind of become at the time. And now the Disney store is kind of back in name only, maybe?
Yeah, so the reason we picked the topic was because very recently they finally decided that Shop Disney was a stupid name. And they're like, this is, we have such a bad reputation from like 15 years of destroying people's orders. How many Shop Disney stories do we have? My favorite, Scott, who used to work with us, bought there was a Little Mermaid lithograph of the mural from the DCA ride that's like long. It was a long, because it's a mural from the load area. They folded it in half. So it's a matted print. So it's on a mat. So it's a big hard card. They folded it in half and put it in the box.
I remember you received something within the last year here at our office, and it's like a box with an item in it, no packing material at all, and a single piece of tape like diagonally across the folded part of the
and
box.
And it almost was out.
Like it was almost out. Yeah. It was
a
like
pin, and it was a pin, so it was like banging all around.
Yep.
And it was amazing that it never came out of that slot that had left open.
I have so many single pins in a giant box. There was one time where the pin got under the bottom flap, and I'm like, this box is empty. And then I had to like shake it, and then I'm like, oh, there's the pin. It fell out.
My favorite thing ever, I don't know if you remember this, when Vinylmation was really hot, especially the Park series, it's very early on, they did a set where they had the 9-inch ones, right, the big ones. And they were very hard to get at the Park, and so everyone was, like, clamoring to get them online. And a couple of them came out that day, two in particular. One was a Festival of the Lion King, which was kind of brown and had, like, some folk art, kind of African art stuff going on. It's hard to explain. It's a weird one. Then there was also a Tiki Room, which was also brown, but the art is very different, right? It has the birds on it. And,
right.
So Disney, Shop Disney, I don't even know if it was Shop Disney yet, but nonetheless, if you ordered one single Tiki Room 9-inch Vinylmation, you did not get it. You accidentally got Lion King. Only if you ordered two Tiki Rooms in the same order did you get your two. And I'll never forget
that. So if
you
wanted the tiki room, you had to buy two of them.
But no one knew that. It was a mistake.
Yeah.
So they accidentally sent everyone who ordered just one Tiki Room 9-inch Funimation, the Lion King one. Everyone was livid, and they're like, well, we're out of them because we did all the twos first.
We're idiots.
My assumption is they miscalculated, shipped out everyone that had multiples first,
right,
and then realized, oh.
We don't have any left.
We don't have enough, but there are Lion King left. Like, maybe they did bad inventory the first time and counted some as Tiki Room. But that was, and if you go online and look around, you'll see stories like this. People that ordered ornaments and got beach towels, and it's never been, their online platform has never been great. I think I had decent success with them when they were Disney Direct for a hot minute back when, remember the Disneyland 50th stuff?
Yes.
Like, that stuff all came intact and was easy to buy. And But since then, the online component has always been kind of nightmarish.
We used to call it shopDisney.
shopDisney, yeah. That's right.
One frustrating component was, I know in 2020, when the Minnie Mouse, the main attraction stuff was coming out.
What a nightmare.
It was intended to be like an in-park release. They couldn't because the parks were closed.
Yeah.
They started doing this shopping event thing that just was a total disaster for
they
everyone
They went through
involved.
Like 10 different ways to try to screw up your order, and they succeeded in all 10 of them.
Yeah, and they couldn't stop the bots anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah, they would be sold out immediately. I know Lee collected all the coffee mugs.
Yeah.
And I think we finally got them all, but it wasn't easy. And then people figured out, oh, shopDisney.uk will release these things a day before regular shopDisney.
Or they, held on longer there. Because I remember we were having a hard time finding one or two pieces from that set, and people from the UK offered. They're like, do you want me to get it for you? I was like, I'll find it. My parents eventually did, which we'll the story of my parents in the Disney store will unravel throughout this podcast. But my parents were, militant about that as they were with other things that were released in the Disney stores over the years. But we have our full Minnie Mouse. I don't know why. I have, like, the headbands and everything. We have every item of that set. I don't know what to do with it, but we have them.
Well, you obviously need to start wearing the headbands.
I should wear the headbands?
Yeah.
And sell it to robots. They're very good at buying them.
They're good at buying them.
What are your first memories of the Disney store?
So we had the Disney store that was closest to me when I grew up was at the King of Prussia Mall outside of Philadelphia. And that was a big one. So that was a big mall. That was a big Disney store. We used to go in it like every time we went to the mall. So like at least once a month, that was the highlight of going to King of Prussia. It was like 35-minute ride from our house. Mm. But like that was the highlight. And I used to go in there and just marvel at all the stuff. And it wasn't until, it wasn't until a lot later than that that I started going to other Disney stores.
Yeah.
Right? Like there weren't many around, but it might not have even been till grad school that, I was in Boston and went around to different ones in Boston, and there was a Disney gallery in Boston, which was the best.
Should we explain what that is? So some Disney stores, it wasn't purely a Disney gallery. I assume it was a Disney store with the gallery component. They didn't have the regular product, too?
I don't think so.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So we had the combined, one of the ones in Jersey, in New Jersey, was the combined one where it was a very large, that might have been the biggest Disney store. I don't know if that was Paramus or which one that was. I didn't drive, so I don't remember which one was which. I'm sure my mother will call after this episode airs with all these corrections. There was one that was giant, and it was like a really well-themed big Disney store. But then there was a room that had two doorways, two arches, like castle entrances and pillars. And it was the gallery section where you'd find like the Walt Disney Collector Society pieces, artwork, watches, like that higher end stuff. So the gallery, like I guess there were separate. I didn't even realize that.
So the one that I went to was in Framingham, Massachusetts. Mm. And that was a store, standalone store in a shopping center, and it did not have any arches or anything like that. It had the front and the sides were all glass, like huge glass windows.
It wasn't like the regular Disney store where that was like a film reel window?
No.
No.
No, it wasn't. It was
like a regular store?
It was like a regular store, but it was the Disney gallery. And it was huge, and there were multiple rooms.
Huh.
But I don't remember there being any like plush or anything that you'd find in a regular Disney store.
Wow.
It was a lot of artwork and statues, figurines, pins.
Huh.
I remember they used to do the little boxed pins.
Yeah.
Right? Or the ones in the weird, like, hexagonal cylinder things, too. So that's where I got all those. But,
yeah. That was, like, before pin trading even started.
Yes.
Because those happened to just be sitting around after pin trading started. But I'm sure we'll get into Disney Store and pins at some point because there's a lot of stories there for sure.
I think a lot of the stories that I hear, though, are that people that were Disney fans, Disney people, it felt kind of like going to a Disney park.
Oh, yeah. I mean, they were beautiful.
For a very long time. Yeah. They were very well themed, and they had
good quality merchandise. Yeah.
Stuff that people were interested in.
Yeah.
And slowly over time, and we can probably get into blaming Bob Chapek at some point, they became sterilized, right? They became sort of a...
They began the early 2000s, there was a little bit of a decline, and then Disney decided, very shockingly, they wanted to get out of the business and sell it to the children's place.
So that was like 2004-ish?
Yeah.
Because that happened about the same time as Michael Eisner stepped down as chairman.
And that's why online became Disney Direct, which was essentially still the good stuff, right? So Disney Direct was selling what you would have expected from the stores, including the gallery, right? So Disneyland's 50th, like, I think they had better merchandise than Disneyland had.
Yeah.
For the 50th anniversary, they did like decades almost, and there were monorail replicas and
boxed pin sets for each
lamp. A lamp with fireworks, like a stained glass lamp with like fireworks above the castle. And
there was
Tiki Room lamp.
Like a five disc CD set of all the music.
Yeah, that might have been in the park too, but that was
that cool. might have been in the park. But yeah, so like 2004-05 time frame, Disney sold the DisneyStore.com to Hoop Retail was the company that runs the children's place.
Yeah. Well, they sold the brick and mortar stores.
They sold the brick and mortar stores, right? And so then, but then it was that when it started being called Shop Disney?
No, Disney Direct.
That was when
Disney's, I think it was still Disney Direct.
But what was it called? What did Hoop Retail call their stores? They still called it Disney Store.
They were
Store.
Disney Store, yeah.
Yeah, but they had a different logo that was like a red.
They
Mickey
made
head
the ugly
circle.
Red circle Target logo thing,
right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, if you went to a Disney store that opened from the children's place, they were garbage.
Yeah.
They were basically I'm trying to think of a very plain store at the mall to explain it as, but like all white, plain displays. Like
super generic
wood floor, like very plain, other than the merch, which is kind of like Bob Chapek's dream, right? Like his thing was always all this stuff makes it hard to concentrate on the merch. So I'm like, Bob, the Disney store was successful for how many years before you got there?
Yeah,
and the store was plenty busy visually, but you're convinced, and I mean, obviously, other retailers were convinced of that too. And the Children's Place Disney store was very sterile and bland and just very blah. They were soulless and heartless and awful.
Yep.
And the merchandise was the same, right? They started gearing. They're like, what adults want stuff? We'll just sell things to kids. So it was all geared towards children. Occasionally, there'd be a couple of adult graphic tees. You're lucky if there was a collectible, maybe a snow globe you could find.
Yeah.
There wasn't much else going on.
No, it was pretty bad.
And clothing for kids.
But you both got into the pin trading stuff, and you're saying that started at the Disney store.
Well, I mean, that started...
Simultaneously.
It started October 1st, 1999, was the official kickoff, along with the Millennium Celebration. So it started in the parks, and then the Disney store released pins every week from October 1st through the end of the year.
Yeah, countdown to the Millennium.
It was the countdown to the Millennium. There were 100 pins.
Yeah.
I assume you both have all of them.
Yes. Yeah.
Including the Davy Crockett error pin.
Yep.
Oh.
They printed the wrong year on the pin.
Uh-huh.
Wow, that's like so that's not quite like when I was collecting baseball cards. The old, you can Google it, the Billy Ripken error card. which was very famous for something that was written on the handle of his bat that he didn't know about when he's standing there holding it.
Wow.
But they could have done that with David Crockett, but no, it's just the date.
Yeah. But so they were released on Saturdays, right?
Yeah.
So
every Saturday there were seven pins.
Kicks off in October of 99. We were here for that, for the start. And then we got home and we're like, oh, Disney Store has pins. And we walked in, I think it was several days after the first release day. Maybe even the second week was out already.
Yeah.
And so we just bought like the first 2 weeks of pins. Then like the next Saturday we went at opening time and realized like, oh, like stuff almost sold out. Every week, more and more people showed up as they realized that pin trading was a thing.
Yep.
Till we got to the point at which I'm 11 years old sitting, and the Disney Store we went to was not in a mall that had interior walkways. It was an outdoor mall, Cross County, the Cross County Shopping Center. And we were outside at 5 in the morning. It's 12 degrees. We're bundled up against the doors of the Disney Store waiting for it to open. But the cool thing that happened was like the community aspect. We got to know all these people. And what everyone would do was if someone was not going to be there 1 week, people would offer to get paid. They're like, oh, I'm not going to be here next week. Can you pick up next week and I'll pick them up the next week for you? And
yeah.
And people started baking stuff for each other. Like the lady would bring us cookies.
Yeah. And I mean, we got, there were at the Disney Store we went to in Boston in Copley Square. It was indoors, thankfully.
Yeah.
there were actually two really close to us. Mm. But we used to go to the one in Boston, and there were five or six people that would show up every week, and we got to be really good friends with all of them. We kept trading with them. We would trade with them at trading events and things. It was, it really, like, without Disney even trying, this got the community aspect of it really, really going to an insane extent that I don't think they ever imagined.
No, because I think they were trying to emulate the, what, 96 Olympics.
Olympic pin trading.
Yeah.
Yes.
And I think very quickly they, like, eclipsed it. They had something
I think I had is that the Coca-Cola ones and all in the big frame? Is that from the 96 Olympics?
Yes.
Yeah. I have that.
Because that's the 25th anniversary.
My friend Molly gave it to us.
Yeah.
That's a cool set. Country Bears are in that.
Oh, yeah? I haven't looked too closely.
Yeah. But, or is that the 20th set that has the Bears? I don't remember. There's a big frame 20th Disney World set and a 25th set. They're both Coke.
Yeah.
I don't remember.
I don't
either
remember.
Way.
But, I mean, that really, like, that's what started the whole Disney community, I think, right?
Yeah.
Like, there was really not a big Disney online community.
And you had to know how to find it.
Yeah. Right?
Like people will tell you, like Jeff Lang and them will tell you about those early days. What is the name of them?
Usenet.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
They all found each other. There weren't a lot of them. Everyone knew everybody.
Yeah.
But like imagine, like you don't know that exists. And so here's all these people that go to Disney all the time suddenly finding each other. And that was the first time I remember talking to normal people, being a relative term, talking to people outside of Disney World about Disney World that weren't my family, right?
Yeah.
Because they'd be like, oh, are you going to this? And are you going for the Millennium Celebration?
And like people, not only like you said, would pick up pins when you weren't there, but people would go and tell everyone else they were going and pick up pins in the parks.
Yeah.
We had people picking up pins in the parks for us all the time.
Did you get your entire set in the stores, or did you have to like look elsewhere to fill little?
We got them in the stores.
We got them in the store.
We were
there at 5 a.m. We got our pins.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm just saying, maybe you got there one day and you were at 5 a.m. and the line was already.
I mean, full. My cousin and I were eBay fiends back then. So like the park stuff, if we weren't there for specific park stuff, you know, we were on eBay looking for stuff. But the Disney Store stuff, we just always made sure we were there.
The best part about those Disney Store pins, they were $4.
Yeah, which is fitting because they're all worthless now.
Now they're like $17 or something for the cheap ones.
I mean.
Wow, yeah.
Yeah.
But they're purely a nostalgia thing, right? They're valueless. Like, there were so many were made that they're not worth anything.
Even your Davy Crockett era.
Yeah, it doesn't mean anything.
Nobody really cares.
No, but it's, for me, I would never get rid of them because they mean something, right?
And you got the binder and everything.
Yeah.
Right. So, yeah, like, you put them all in a nice binder.
Yeah,
and they
it was
sold
a special time. There's a lot of memories connected to them, which is what, I think the same with the Disney parks. I think Disney discounts the importance of the stores, right? But I think about How many stores are there that we have memories of, right? The original World of Disney stores,
yeah.
which were intricately themed, had these giant figurines and figures of characters, mm-hmm. and incredible stuff in them. And the store, you remember, like you, it puts you in a good mood to shop, right? And I think they miss that. And they're like, we should make World of Disney look like a warehouse. Now I go in there, I'm like, I don't want to buy anything from this store. I don't want to support the existence of this warehouse you've built with Disney merchandise.
It's
this
not
is
fun
horrendous.
To go. Yeah.
I don't mean to get us too far off track, but I'm intrigued by the pin discussion.
Sure.
Is there a singular pin or a group of pins that are like the Babe Ruth rookie card of Disney pin trading? Is there one pin that everybody knows is like the pin where you're like, that one's worth a lot.
There's not a singular, but there's, I could probably name some stuff right now.
Yeah.
That you'll remember was like insanity back then.
Yes. Is there a pin that's worth a lot of money?
There's plenty.
What pins are worth the most money?
I mean,
WDI LE300 stuff is today what's worth money.
But yeah.
Back then, what, like Mickey, there were things called surprise pins.
Yes.
You didn't know they were being released. You had to find them.
They just released them.
They were weird ones, right? Mickey for president. It's like the presidential seal with Mickey's icon in it.
There was a set of my first visit pins that were surprise release in the parks. And we were here. And we spent a whole day going around to every park to get them. Yeah. There were like five or six in the set.
Yeah.
There was a really cool Pirates of the Caribbean with the jail scene.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Well, it became referred to as silver jail scene or whatever. It was something about the coloring.
So that was a really big deal back then.
So
wet paint.
Oh, they Lord. Made,
I was here for wet paint, which was insanity.
Yeah. Yep.
They made the wet paint with Donald, the nephews, he's chasing them.
They made a pin.
They made a pin of that. It's very early on and people went berserk. And we were here for it. Oh my God. We waited at Animal Kingdom in line for I don't even know how long.
There are Pokemon cards that are worth like hundreds of thousands of dollars now.
I don't know
Disney pins that are worth six figures?
No. I don't think so.
No,
or Sorcerer's
probably,
of the Magic Kingdom cards or something like
there's
that.
There's probably a handful someone would pay four figures for.
Yeah.
There's definitely a bunch of people would pay three figures for. There's tons.
Oh yeah. The pins that are, in my mind, worth a lot that I would pay a lot of money for are not ones that came out after Disney started pin trading. They're all pre-99 cast member pins, right? Like, I have a AT&T pin that was the Spaceship Earth cast member costume pin, right? Yeah. Like, that's the kind of pin that's worth a ton of money now. It wasn't one that you could buy.
Okay.
The Nautilus, we have the full Nautilus costume from 20,000 Leagues.
Yeah.
The pin that came on the hat, right? The big Nautilus N.
Yes, the N.
thing. Yeah.
I mean, yeah. So a lot of those those are the kinds of things that are worth a lot.
That's a four-figure pin. I got it less than that, but it's a four-figure.
And then there were also ones that were cast member only pins that came out during pin trading. And there's a set of lockers. Remember the lockers?
Yeah.
Right? So it was cast member only. You had to buy them in Company D.
They were like the first hinged pins too as they opened.
Yeah. So there was a set of five or six.
Now hinge is a totally different thing.
And there was a Mickey, a Minnie, a Pluto, a Goofy.
They're
it was
cute.
Like it was like if the characters had lockers and there was a set of them.
Yeah.
There's actually one in the Van Eaton auction that's next weekend.
Oh, cute.
That set.
You know how many pictures we have to send Billy for this episode now because it became pin trading?
That's my fault. I apologize, Billy. You can take it up with me.
Have to find them.
We can get
but
back
the,
to
the...
Well, let him finish the story.
I mean, so... But that's the kind... Yeah, there are some. And I mean, like, my wife worked at the Disney store in the early 2000s.
Did she give you the hookup? Like, hey, we have these pins that are going to be stocked tomorrow.
Well, there weren't a lot of Disney store pins anymore at that point. It was mostly in the parks, but
they did so the quick progression of Disney store pins, right? They did the Millennium.
Yes.
Then there was the 100 Years.
The 100
Years.
100
pins
was the
for 100 Years of Magic.
Yeah, and that did not go over anywhere near as well as the Millennium.
No, it started strong with like the Walt Lockett pin with him as a kid and he was an adult. Then it died quick, and then they tried to revive by doing, they're like, well, we can't stop making pins. They did 12 months of Magic, which every month there was a bunch of, for 12 full months, there was a whole bunch of pins, which didn't move that great either. No. And that was kind of the end.
That was the end. So, but this is like 2004, 5-ish time frame, when they started shutting down all the Disney stores. My wife worked at a Disney store that got shut down. The coolest thing was, remember the carpet with the Mickey heads? It was like the blue and purple carpet.
Mm-hmm.
I have a Mickey head.
That's cool.
The carpet. Because when they shut down her store, they cut up the carpet and they gave everybody a piece.
Yeah.
So I have
the. So that was an older one then, because later it was red.
Yeah.
The later stores had the Mickey marquee face in the ground, the mosaic.
Yeah.
And then it was red carpet
inside.
But yeah, so the original, if you go back to the 80s, the original is that light blue and purple. And I mean, those colors, that cast costume, my God, the sweater.
Oh, yeah, the sweater.
Tremendous. I love that. They did plush. Of course, Japan did it. The Japan Disney stores did plush 2 years ago that I bought of Mickey and Minnie. They're wearing those costumes, and they have the clapboard.
Yep.
And I love them. They also did a rug of the mosaic, the Mickey in the floor. I bought all that stuff.
Yeah.
It's so cool.
So that was like, I mean, that was, the pins at the stores really died down.
Yeah.
The pins at the parks were still taking off. But, I mean, like, the Millennium pins started as...
Why did they die down? There's people waiting in line at 5 a.m. for pins.
It wasn't handled the same way, right? I think people wanted the Millennium pins, but then those like, didn't retain any value, right? So people immediately realized they bought... Because what pin people do, they bought to trade, right? So people bought 2, 3, 4 sets.
Yes.
Then they realized as the weeks went on, they're like, I'm getting stuck with these. And so you walk around with these books at pin trading events full of these Millennium pins. You're like, well, the Disney store stuff doesn't move. The other side of that was they weren't doing limited edition, right?
Yes.
So, like, the parks, like, there was a period where I think pretty much daily limited edition pins were coming out at the parks, right?
Yep.
So there was... You know, if you're a collector, there was so much to keep up with. So inevitably, there was something in the course of the week that you wanted. Also, at one point, there were like 3 nights a week you could go to pin trading at Walt Disney World.
In the Contemporary.
Well, Contemporary was Friday.
Yeah.
So this was Grand Canyon Concourse. You know where the Fantasia store is now?
Yeah.
There used to just be like in the old setup with the weird hanging lights and very old Contemporary stuff sitting there. There was just like a kiosk that had pins, and they'd let you take all the benches and everything around
it
would become pin trains. So that was all open.
And
Fantasia,
the
Fantasia store was in where the arcade is across the way.
Yes.
And eventually they moved it, but back then you could pin trade out there in the open. Polly was Wednesdays for a while.
Yeah.
And then
I only ever went to Contemporary.
Pop was once a month.
Something like that.
You could go like all the time.
I remember seeing a woman go into Epcot one time in an ECV, and she had those stackable toolboxes like
the
from Home Depot.
She's probably going to the pin event.
Like being towed by her ECV.
Yes.
And I was like, how
people
does she
used
keep
to go like people used to go to pin events and have like a trailer attached to their car with pins. It was crazy.
Yeah, it was.
But yeah, I mean, so the great thing about pin trading was, you know, the Disney store, because I think the 100 Years collection wasn't great. That's the, like, Iris Bigler, remember that collection, and I'm like, this is kind of junky. Like, they didn't put a lot of effort into it like the parks did.
The park stuff got really cool. Like, you talked about the lockers. I will never forget my favorite pin. The manhole cover.
Oh, yeah, that opened.
They did. It's the Disney World manhole cover with the D.
Yes.
And it opens, and Goofy's in a maintenance outfit, and it opens, like, three-dimensionally.
Yeah.
So, like, you have the...
It's a hinge that opens.
Like that, and then Goofy opens like that across it, so he's, like, popping out of the manhole. Is so cool. And that was very early on.
That was a crazy one, too,
But, I mean... Yeah, the park, the store stuff wasn't good. It was all small and kind of...
So it, the parks is where it really took off, and then you know, the Disney shows would come out with stuff here and there, but it was like a lot of special occasion stuff. It wasn't massive sets.
Something we have to talk about if we're going to talk about Disney Store, when you would pre-order a movie.
Oh yeah, and you got the lithographs.
The later pins were part of it too, right?
Yeah.
When I was a kid, it was what lithograph watch. There were watches for a while.
Yeah.
Lithograph set and watch. And then when pins took off, they started throwing a pin in.
Yep.
But kids, what you would do back in the day is you'd go to your Disney store and pre-order your VHS, one that sticks in my mind, Toy Story. The original release of Toy Story on VHS. And you go pre-order it. It wouldn't come out for like a month or two or three later. You pre-order it, and then the big exciting day comes. Like, well, when are we going to drive over there and pick up the movie?
Yeah.
Well, we got to go on Saturday, and you have to wait all week. And like, I don't want to wait. I want to watch Toy Story.
The other thing that I thought you were going to say was the what was the club called when you spent so much
club
money?
Disney?
What? No.
The Disney Club.
No, it was.
Oh, before Disney.
Before
Club?
That. Disney Club was
Magic
something
Magic Kingdom
you,
Club?
No, that was... So Magic Kingdom Club was
it
like usually through your employer.
Store, yeah.
No, there was a... it wasn't a club. Like, you couldn't sign up for it, but if you spent enough money at the Disney store, you would get, like, special offers and things.
We got the... Oh, Best Guest.
Best Guest. That's it. Yes. Yep. So that was a thing, like, you couldn't... Wasn't a thing you signed up for. It was like an invitation only thing. Yeah. If you spent enough money at Shop Disney or Disney Store, and then they would.
There were special pins. Even
there were pins. Yeah. There was. I remember there was a for one of Donald's birthdays. They had like a set of three. They were almost like silver ingots. In a box, you got ornaments. Like Christmas time, they would have get Best Guest ornaments. Like you got all kinds of stuff when you bought when you ordered things through the, and that was like through the catalog.
Yeah.
That wasn't even the stores; that was the Disney catalog.
Yeah, which was still an offshoot.
Did they have the? Yeah. Did they do the like pre-sales on movies that were coming out of the vault too, or only on new stuff?
Yeah, whatever
they
was
did.
Coming out. Yeah, there was always something to pre-order.
Yeah.
There was never a time where you walked into a Disney store and they had nothing for you to pre-order.
Yep.
Yeah. Especially by the time I was a couple years old, like at that point they're pumping VHS out.
Oh,
probably
like
one a month, if not more.
Yes.
And I don't know what the situation is now or what it was recently, but I know people that worked at the Disney store and moved to Disney World or something. Like they were
you could.
A cast member just like you,
you
would
were,
be if you
yep.
worked in the park.
So Angel was a part-time cast member at the Disney store and she got a Walt Disney it was called Casual Temporary.
Yeah, CT.
CT ID card that would get her into the parks for free, and you would get cast member discounts on merchandise, and she could go to Company D, and you would get discounts on food. It was a full-fledged employee of the Walt Disney Company.
There was a time when my brother was a college program, and then he would keep his CT status as long as he worked one shift a year.
That was
so
a thing for a long time.
He could come down on Christmas break and work one shift, and then he could get into the park for free the whole time he was down.
Yeah.
Then someone
they
finally,
got rid of that.
That was not that long ago. You're probably talking 10, 12 years ago. They finally were like, oh, did you know people could do this? Finally management figured it out.
Right.
Took them long enough. And they're like, yeah, we're going to stop that. And then that's when they cut down on the part-time in general, too.
Yes.
They like waged war on the part-time people.
Even like within the last 5 years, they had changed. Now, some of this is pre-COVID. But they had changed it so a lot of part-time people had to work at least three shifts a week, which really hurt a lot of people, right?
That was about the same time that happened.
I would say this is like 2019.
But then they learned how to trade shifts, and as long as you could trade your shift, you were good.
As long as you could trade your shift, you were good.
But anyway, that's really off topic.
We're getting way off topic. But
But
when Children's Place bought them, they lost a lot of their benefits.
They lost all of those benefits.
So a lot of people left the company.
The stores, absolutely. But yeah, so like Children's Place bought them, then you weren't an employee of Disney anymore. It was kind of pointless to work there. It went from Disney Store to Shop Disney. That was still under the Children's Place when they renamed it.
You're talking about the website.
Yeah.
I think Disney Direct became Shop Disney.
Okay.
I think Shop Disney was after Disney took it back.
That's what I'm trying to figure out. Because
this might be a thing Wikipedia.
I seem to remember the Shop Disney logo being the red Mickey Target icon looking thing.
I don't think it was.
But I might be thinking of something else.
Now there are like micro Disney stores within Target.
But then there were all, so before we even get to that, there were Disney outlets.
Yeah.
Right? So the outlets
still exist.
They do. There's very few of them. But they do.
We're not talking
exist.
About Character Warehouse. We're talking about Disney Store outlets.
Yes.
Okay.
So way, way back, there used to, like way, way back, Character Warehouse was like a park
thing.
Character Premiere was the other one. There were two.
Yeah.
And they would get a lot of merch from Disneyland.
Yeah.
And sell it here. And then there were places in Disneyland that were third parties that would get a lot of leftover merch from here and sell it.
There's one in Vegas.
Yeah. And then I remember here, there not long after World of Color debuted, there was a lot of World of Color merch with a logo that they decided not to use.
Yeah.
And that was all in a big tent in the parking lot of one of these outlet malls here. And it was like insane.
There was also one at Sawgrass Mills down in like Fort Lauderdale area. There was a big, I think that was a Character Premiere.
That's a Character Warehouse.
Though. A Character Warehouse. Yeah. So but I got some good stuff. Correct, I got some LE artwork out of there.
There was one in St. Augustine too for the longest time. That
but
was
we have to clarify, Character Warehouses is are park operated and park stuff. Now, Disney Store ones have had park stuff. They're are some in the Northeast my parents go to. I can't say where they are because they'll be mad at me that I told people it exists. But in the Northeast, I'm not even joking. In the Northeast, there are still Disney outlets where they sell, I would say primarily as far as park stuff, Disneyland merchandise goes in, which seems berserk for how far from Disneyland they are. No,
but those are outlets.
Yeah. But they also have like generic Disney Store shop Disney stuff.
Right.
But they'll get park stuff
too. They'll get park stuff. And the other thing for a long time, and I don't know I don't think it happened anymore, but if you bought a park item and it like didn't fit, you could return it to your local Disney store and they would put it on clearance.
Yeah.
So you could find there was usually a rack of clearance stuff in the back that had park stuff random on it because people would make returns.
Can I do a brief history of the Disney store just so we have all our timeline?
Just
so
that would be ideal.
There is a Disney store speakeasy in the Northeast that we're not allowed to tell people about though. That's the thing.
The first Disney store opened in Glendale, in the Glendale Gallery in Glendale, California, March 28th, 1987. I've been to that one. We actually went to the when it reopened as the new Disney store, the one with the light-up tree things. The first Disney store outside of California was Bridgewater Commons in Bridgewater, New Jersey. I wonder if that's the one. Maybe that was the nice one we went to. That was June 18th, 1988. They opened in London, November 1990. Japan, 92. I'm trying to just find, like, name changes eventually. Oh, they did two remodeled two stores in the 2000s as prototypes, Costa Mesa and Cherry Hill, New Jersey. They had more space and a high-tech look where theme park tickets could be bought via computer stations.
Yep, there was a kiosk.
Wow, they did them all. 20 stores were redone in that style by April 2001. Prototype. When did they sell? I want to know when they sold the children's books.
It was 04, 05.
Yeah, okay. Even though Disney stores maintained strong sales, mounting costs of sales and operation, and the loss of key executives who had driven the Disney stores to success led the Walt Disney Company to convert the Disney stores into a licensed operation. The Japan Disney stores were sold to the Oriental Land Company in 2002, while most North American stores were sold and licensed in November of 2004 to the Children's Place. The Walt Disney Company kept their stores in Europe, along with the flagship store in Manhattan, which was converted to the World of Disney store run by Walt Disney Parks and Resorts in 2004, while the Children's Place got the Chicago flagship location. On June 2nd, 2005, Disney Soda Fountain and Studio Store opened at the El Capitan building on the ground floor, replacing a Disney store. They signed a 15-year licensing agreement with Children's Place, Hoop Holdings. They made money, blah, blah, blah. I want to know when they went back.
Well, they went back when Hoop went bankrupt.
Yeah.
So they signed a 15-year licensing agreement, but Hoop didn't last that long.
I'm trying to see when they went.
I know there were some major remodels in, like, 2013, but I don't know if that was because they took the stores back.
Might have been.
Yeah.
So on June 8, 2007, Disney Consumer Products and the Children's Place settled the licensing agreement dispute in which Disney indicated 130 unfixed breaches. The Children's Place agreed to have a new prototype store design approved by Disney by the end of June, with the prototype to be rolled out to 234 existing stores by January 31st, 2012, while 18 new prototype stores would open by early 2009. At the Chicago flagship, about 165 other locations, hoops would get maintenance up to date by June 30th, 2008. Restrictions on Disney to give direct merchandising licenses to other specialty retailers was loosened as well. When did they... Oh, here you go. Reunited operations. Hoop Retail, the Children's Place subsidiary, operated the Disney stores, announced on March 20, 2008 that they were in talks to sell Disney store brand back to Disney. Hoop Retail filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy in March. On May 1, 2008, 231 Disney stores in North America once again became the property of Disney under the Disney Consumer Products arm. James Fielding was named president of Disney stores worldwide. In Europe at the time, the chain had 107 locations. The San Francisco showcase location was closed in 2008. Furthermore, Disney announced in November 2009 they were planning a massive relaunch and rebranding of Disney store locations, spearheaded by Apple's Steve Jobs. The new store look and feel was designed by New York-based design firm Pompey AD and was referred to as Imagination Parks, which the store on Fifth Avenue, or not Fifth Avenue, Times Square, still emulates that in places. The first of these stores were opened in May 2010 on Long Island. I went to that one for the opening. Madrid and Southern California. I think, in fact, might even be on this YouTube channel, a tour of that Long Island store. 40 more of this format were opened in 2011. They closed the Fifth Avenue World of Disney store in January 2010 when I bought all their pins. Disney.
It's Tom's fault.
Story time. So when they got the stores back, and then they decided they were Walt Disney World was operating the World of Disney store. They decided we're going to just get rid of it. And they wanted Bob Iger wanted the Times Square, so that's was the vision, right? And often people explain the difference between Michael Eisner and Bob Iger in this way. Michael Eisner is Fifth Avenue, Bob Iger is Times Square, right? I think that's a good way to sum up their personalities.
Yeah.
Too. One built in Paris, France. The other built in Shanghai, China. So anyway, so as the store got near closing, they started to discount things heavily, very heavily. And so we went, I would dare say, a couple times a week to check on what was happening. And so there was a point at which they accidentally put art on sale. We bought some art and other things. And what I was waiting for was pins, right? So they sold limited edition park pins at that store, and because then also their own limited edition stuff. Yep. But I, like, these are real park pins I could trade. I wanted to get them cheap. So I remember they hit 50 or 60% off. I bought some. 70% off, I bought some. We get towards, it's the last week, we get there the day they start the 90% off. And we go, are there any purchase limits? There are no purchase limits. I would like every remaining pin in the store, please. Now, at this point, there's some weird stuff left. So what I ended up with was about, I would say, 80 or 90 pins of Sonny with a Chance,
yep.
About 50 Hannah Montanas, probably 50 High School Musicals. I don't even know what they were the weirdest pins, but we bought several hundred pins at 90% off.
And then you traded them.
The idea being to trade them at the parks, right? Yeah. 'Cause the,
right.
Yeah.
Like what they call them, scrappers or whatever? You just get
scrappers
like...
Scrappers and...
No.
Scrappers is fake garbage.
Oh, I thought scrapper just meant a junky pin nobody wanted that you could trade to cast members because they can't sell them.
Scrappers
that's actually like a fake pin.
It's actually counterfeit, yeah.
Oh, man. I've just opened a can of worms.
You sure did.
Well, this episode has nothing to do with pins, so we don't have to talk about it.
It's we're going to have to retitle it now.
But I've shown everyone how Disney I know nothing about pins, which is important information.
For but yeah, so
them,
I had
just call them junk.
I had 300 or 400... specifically Disney Channel pins. And so what I did was we went to the parks. I was like, I just want to get rid of them.
Yeah, you traded
The rule is no lanyard can have two of the same pin. So you can't trade a cast member something already on their lanyard, and you can't give them two of the same thing.
Right.
So I just went to every lanyard. It's like, if they didn't have any of the pins I had, I was two pins. Just get rid of them.
Yeah.
They must be gone.
Yes.
Which is similar to what happened with my cousin Ralph. There's an infamous pin, the Millennium Dancer pin.
Uh-huh.
So when they launched the Millennium Celebration, the original art style had people, like these people, they were like full color, faceless
Yeah.
Human and they had like banners.
And they had like, yeah, streamers that they were like dancing with.
These to celebrate the future him.
Yes. So between that and the rings, right? Because the 2000 logo had the Mickey ear rings. The Olympic people got really mad and said to Disney, "Yeah, I mean you could see it a little bit there. Yeah, right?
It's we under have it up our there. Light. We have
it is up there.
Yeah. Well, you might be able to. I don't know if this banner. Yeah,
Well, there's rings, right? But you get the idea. So the Olympic people got mad between the people with tassels, the colors, and the rings." They're like, this is too close to us. Can you please not? And Disney accepted the request and liquidated whatever they had that emulated that, which I think there wasn't much else with it other than the pin.
So those pins, I think, originally were designed to be given out to people who booked packages.
Oh, were they?
Yes.
Okay.
So I think if you booked a hotel package after the millennium started, you got a pin. Mm. And then they had to stop giving it. So they were never for sale. They were never for sale.
So Disney, to get rid of them, the character warehouses come back into our story, was selling them for 50 cents?
I remember like six for $5 or something.
They were, I think they dropped to 50 cents at one point.
Yeah.
And my cousin Ralph decided to buy them all.
Yeah.
I mean thousands.
Yeah.
Thousands of Millennium Dancer pins. And then my cousin Michael and I would come visit. Ralph would give us bags.
Yeah.
He'd give us bags and drop us off at the park. And our job would be to get rid of all these Millennium Dancer pins.
Yeah.
So we literally put one on every lanyard in every park whenever we came. And Ralph would do the same when we weren't here. So there's a chance, folks, if you have this pin at home, there is a chance that I have touched this pin at some point, or at least know who it belongs
to. So I, and at some point in there, I had somebody I knew got a whole bunch of them. Mm. And they were not ones, they were ones that were never distributed. So there were 12 in a package with tissue paper, and it was wrapped up in a bag.
Yeah.
And I had probably 20 bags of these original ones, like that were never distributed. Mm. Which I put on lanyards a bunch too because they were, I mean, I love that pin. I think it's a great pin.
They used to be, if you were a pin trader for those first 10 years of pin trading, you would see them on every lanyard.
Yes.
They were ubiquitous. Then at some point, someone in pin trading got the idea of like, there's some old stuff circulating that we need to just take down and probably destroy.
Yep.
And the Millennium Dancer pins vanished. And I don't think I've seen one on a lanyard since.
No.
I think they destroyed them all and moved on at some point.
Yeah. No, there were definitely pins that showed up on every lanyard, and then they just had to pull them off.
So, yeah, Oriental Land Company sold the Japanese stores back to Disney. Disney took over Retail Networks Company Limited, an Oriental Land Company subsidiary, on March 31st, 2010. They did Disney Baby Stores were a pilot.
Yeah, I remember Disney
Baby Stores. Mm-hmm.
Those were a thing, like Bye Bye Baby and
crossover
Babies
with the Muppet Babies.
Yeah.
No.
That was a missed opportunity.
Yeah.
Well, now when do they start closing? In early March 2021, Disney announced that it would close at least 155 stores in North America. On May 5th, 2021, they announced it would close all the Disney store locations in Europe. On June 18th, it was announced the original Glendale Galleria location would close. On July 23rd, it was announced that most Canadian stores would be closing. The final 1990s pink and green location, that's the original look, at Chicago Ridge Mall in Chicago Ridge, Illinois, was announced as part of these closures. On August 23rd, it was announced 59 stores would close on or before September 15th, leaving only 22 stores remaining in the U.S. It was also announced that the last three Canadian stores would close as well. On December 24th, it was announced that the second-to-last full-price Disney store located in Bellevue, Washington, would be closed on January 19th, 2022.
So there's like
there's 21 left in the U.S.
and they're all outlets.
They are all outlets at this point.
And I think there's two of them in Pennsylvania.
Well, I guess they're counting the New York City flagship.
Okay.
Maybe the Chicago flagship? No, that closed.
That closed.
The flagship has no fleet.
But I think there's only like 20 some left. Two of them are in Pennsylvania.
21 in the U.S., one in the U.K., and one in Ireland. I mean, obviously, the Japan ones exist under different ownership.
Yeah.
Eventually again.
Thankfully.
Yeah.
That's sad.
They make tremendous merchandise, though. I know it will shock you that the Japanese make tremendous merchandise.
People watch Boxed In. I have merchandise that you all have brought back from Japan where their flagship store actually has its own merchandise just for that store. It's like celebrating the anniversary of the specific store.
But they always have their own stuff beyond that, right? Yeah. So my thing is, like, it's hard to shop for people like Disney friends or people in this company at Tokyo Disney because a lot of people haven't been there, so I buy you stuff from an attraction you don't even know. But the Disney store always has, like, really creative movie merchandise, I will say, like, especially the animated characters. So, like, Jake will always get some crazy Stitch thing when I come back. You know, you all usually give you something for your significant other that's Cinderella-related.
She does like Cinderella.
Yeah, so it's great. If you're in Japan and you're shopping for, like, Disney people that don't know what the Tokyo Disney Resort stuff is, highly recommend going to a Disney store. Also, several of them are very highly themed. The Shibuya is the really pretty one, right?
Shibuya is the one that had it. That was the original.
Castle facade.
They just have like a, 25th anniversary?
35th anniversary.
Yeah.
Where they had their own spirit jersey, their own lounge fly. Plush.
Pins.
And a whole set of plush and a whole set of pins.
The plush are cute.
They're on Boxed In. All that stuff is on one of the episodes of Boxed In.
Check out Boxed In, a top-rated show on our other network.
WDWNT-TV.
One of the best shows in the world.
Home of News Tonight also.
Yes.
It's the number one show in the entire Disney community that involves bourbon and unboxing things once every 7 weeks.
Yeah.
I think.
About that.
It's in the neighborhood.
But can we talk about the design of the old stores? Because I think that's so much of what's important.
They had like a castle in them, right? Didn't they?
No, so like the original ones are that they talked about that blue and purple and teal, right? Those had those incredible window displays, right, with the figures and the characters are rocking back and forth like they're producing a movie, right?
Yeah,
and there were all kinds of three-dimensional things hanging from the ceilings.
Yeah, so that kind of came later, right? So the original. Up at the top of the shelving, there were vignettes, right?
That's right.
And so the Paris, the Disney store in Disney Village, that's not a Disney store but has kept all of its Disney store display and feel. If you go in that one, that's pretty much an original Disney store. So there are vignettes with character statues up on the tops of the walls.
Yeah.
That's the original. Then you're talking about like that later in the late 90s redo when the production theme.
Yes.
Like Mickey's the director sitting on the chair that moves.
Yeah.
And someone's on a magic carpet flying. And the Dalmatians are like knocking over lights.
Yes. Yep.
Or something. Yeah, that's later. Big Bad Wolf's breaking the register. Like my favorite vignette, the pigs are like painting behind the register and the wolf has come out of some crate to like try and eat them. It's fantastic.
Yeah.
But then there's like an in-between, right? There were in-between ones. So one of the ones, I don't know which Jersey, Connecticut, or New York location it was, but if they opened around the opening of Euro Disney, the mural behind the register was the castle. Paris, the chateau. And that's burned into my memory from when I was a kid was that mural. I was like, that castle's really pretty.
Uh-huh.
And I had no idea. I was like, I think that's that park they just opened that I'm never going to go to. I also remember being in the Disney store in 2001 and look at the TVs above the register and going, wow, a Ferris wheel with a sun on it. Is that a Disney park? What are they doing in California? We don't have that.
Joe in the WIGS Corps just posted that with the, I don't know.
That's later. That's Imagination Park.
That's the castle ones, right?
That's Imagination Park. Yeah.
That's later. Yep.
Which those were like a valid attempt for the modern age. They were good enough. The problem for me was still merchandise.
At that point, the problem was merchandise.
Nothing
an adult would want to purchase.
Like they rethemed the stores because they thought that was the problem, but that wasn't the problem.
The merch got slightly better than Children's Place, but it was still lame.
Mostly junk.
Yeah, and it was still geared towards kids.
Way too much geared towards kids. It was all cheap, like a lot of cheap plastic stuff.
Yeah, there were some attempts, right? Like Vinylmation started to be sold. Things like that were attempts to bring collectibles in.
Do you think there's a business case to be made, though, that targeting kids was a good idea? Because maybe they're you know, obviously Disney connects with children, but also maybe they were able to make stuff that's higher profit margin.
Look, I think they definitely succeeded with children's merchandise. I think there was a market they excluded
by not having things
for everyone, right? Yeah. I think there are, we know there are lots of Disney adults in this world, and they knew that back then. They knew that in the 80s and 90s. The gallery was not built for children.
No.
The gallery store section of the stores was built
because Millennium pins weren't released for kids. You didn't have kids lining up, well, you, but not other kids lining up at 5 in the morning to buy those pins. No, they were all adult things.
No, so, like, look, and I still think the percentage back then made sense. I would dare say, like, 60 to 75% of the stores that existed then was geared towards children, and probably the last 25, 35% was probably, like, collectibles and adult clothing, which I think worked for them.
It did. It worked for a long time.
They only sold the children's place because what we talked about, like, it wasn't like they were losing money. They just they changed management. No one wanted to deal with the headache of operating stores. And they thought it was a better Disney at that time under Eisner was looking for a lot of easy answers. And it was easier to license them. And then eventually, like, to Bob Chapek's credit, look, the guy was a dunce otherwise. He did two good things in his life. Number one was the vault, right? That was a genius marketing play. Number two was putting the Disney stores back under Disney jurisdiction. It's the only two things of value that man ever did.
I don't, and I don't even know whether you give him credit for that because
I'm pretty sure he was in charge of that.
Well, no, but I mean, Hoop went out of business, right?
Like, but they could have certainly looked for another company to.
They could have. Yeah, I guess they could have. But if Hoop was doing well. It's not like Chapek was going to go out and bring them back.
Yeah.
They came back because Hoop went bankrupt.
Why did Bob Chapek retire? Poor earnings. Yeah, he retired.
That's one way of putting it. I mean, he certainly got a nice little retirement package.
I mean, he was in consumer products forever.
Yeah, he was.
Oh, so actually, no, I'm corrected. He was home video. 93, he wasn't there when they took back the Disney stores. He took over consumer products in 2011. So he was kind of the beginning of the decline of the Disney store.
Yep.
Surprise.
Surprise, surprise.
Surprise.
Because but all the merch
vault.
Was junk.
So he did one good thing in his life.
The vault.
The vault, which is actually something that a lot of people hated.
They did because it made them rebuy movies they already had, right? Yeah. But I think the vault, I mean, you can't argue the vault was genius, right? Like, also, I liked it as a kid because, and I think families liked it because it was, we haven't watched that movie in years. Oh, we'll get it on VHS and we'll watch it. And
yeah.
It was a good reason. And the other thing, like, I hate to give this human being credit, but I think it kept those franchises relevant in a way that no other studio has been able to keep their movies relevant, right? It gave the idea of these are things you come back to. Right?
Yeah.
It's not a movie you watch once in your life. They're things that generationally come back. And obviously we live in streaming now, so you watch them whenever. But that was, I think, a big reason why some of those older movies like, you know, Dumbo and Lady
are still popular.
Obviously, it's a big part of it is because they're legendary and they're great films. But a big part of that is because they had a good plan to keep them relevant.
Yeah. Yep.
But yeah, other than that, he was a doofus. Total doofus.
Yeah, I mean, so, like, getting back to, like, the Disney stores now, like, I'll go to
which
the ones.
Which Disney store?
The ones.
The outlets?
The outlets? Yeah, the outlets.
They're all very plain. A lot of them still look like Children's Place version
they
of
do.
The store.
They do. But I mean, like, it's sad, really.
It's very sad. I mean, this was, for park people that don't live near the parks, it was the connection.
It was the connection, yeah.
Do we know now, are they making any changes under the hood now that Shop Disney is
Yeah, they fired Disney everybody. Store?
But, I mean, is it still going to be, like, crappy fulfillment?
It is.
They're outsourcing customer service now, right?
Like, yeah.
That's the supposedly why they fired those 150 people, right?
I don't think it's getting better.
This isn't, like, the name is better. Does this mean there will be a seismic shift in the coming months? I don't know.
I don't think so.
Does it mean they'll open a handful of brick and mortar at some point in the future? Like, I don't, we'll never be at the point where they're in every mall, right? Like, we're not going to ever have that
again. No, I mean, we have the airport now. That's it, right?
What, the airport? Those aren't Disney stores either. Those are park operated. Parks.
Disney World store or whatever.
Yeah, they're park operated. Yeah.
They're park operated.
I mean, that's a way to dip your toe into it is something like airports. So
I think, like, in very big markets, it would be cool to have a handful of flagship stores.
It makes sense to have one in Manhattan, in Chicago.
Yeah, it's crazy that Chicago doesn't have one.
Like, it, yeah, it just, it makes sense.
Yeah.
Like, you know, FAO Schwartz had how many brick and mortar stores?
I mean, yeah, but what we're seeing is endemic. Them? Yeah, I mean, this is all endemic of everyone, right? Like, God, all the stores I went to the mall for no longer exist. Disney Store, KB Toys.
KB, yeah.
God, they're all Babbage's, gone.
Barnes & Noble.
Barnes & Noble still exists.
Barnes & Noble still exists.
It is hanging on by a thread.
Yeah.
Borders pretty much gone, I think.
Yeah.
Sharper Image, they're gone?
Oh, Sharper Image. Well, that
My favorite
Sharper
personal.
Image kind of basically turned into Hot Topic.
Yeah. My personal masseuse, old Brooke Stone, remember?
Oh, Brooke Stone, yes.
Sit in the chair.
Yep.
Yeah, those are disappearing.
The Radio mall used Shack. To be cool. We just went to Roosevelt Field just a couple days ago, and it was very sad. I was like, I don't even know what to look in at this mall. Like,
yeah.
If I don't need clothes, there's nothing fun.
No.
Like, there's no, I don't know. I want nonsense. Sell me nonsense.
Yeah, right. And
something fun.
And sell me nonsense, but don't make me go to Target to get it is really the thing, right? Like, this whole store within a store thing is...
Well, that's already dead, basically.
It is, right? Like, like Disney did the thing with Target. Sephora put stores inside of Kohl's, and that didn't help either one of those two companies.
Yeah.
I mean, part of the problem is that, well, if you're going to have a store inside of a store, it has to be exclusive. But when Walmart has a bunch of random Disney junk, too, then what is the point of the store within a store?
The only cool thing that came out of the Target thing was when Galaxy's Edge opened and they did exclusive merchandise.
They did exclusive
merch. So there
merch.
Were those plush and stuff that were Galaxy's Edge themed, but only at Target. I was like, well, that makes sense.
That's exactly what makes sense. But they just didn't have enough of that stuff to sustain it.
No.
Because anything else was random, generic stuff, and
but
no
that's
one
the company's
it.
Problem in general with merchandising is generic,
it's
right?
Too generic.
It's nothing's a risk. Nothing's cool and interesting. Yeah. Like, I don't know the last time I, other than a couple of D23 pins, I don't remember the last time I bought anything on shopDisney, the website.
Right.
I couldn't tell you the last time I bought anything that wasn't a D23
and
member.
And it was only D23 because that's the only place you could get it.
That's who they sell through.
Yeah.
Never mind that they screwed up my D23 membership order several times.
Yeah. Well, of course.
Yeah.
But, like, I think for sure if there was, and here's the thing, like, the Disney stores in Japan release cool stuff.
They do great.
And people buy it.
They're packed.
I don't understand. And I'm not even talking about brick and mortar, right? Like, they could release the stuff online, too.
Yeah.
But, like, why is it that the Disney stores in Japan can create such amazing merchandise and people buy it and they love it and it sells out, and then the Disney stores here create generic garbage and it doesn't sell, and then it goes, like, can they not just, like, look and see?
I think it's they're afraid. I think they're very afraid to do that stuff. I think the people who design merchandise, here's the sad truth. There are a lot of very talented, great people that work on designing Disney merchandise. And the only time, generally, you get to see their stuff shine through is pins. Because generally, with the pin events and stuff, they kind of get away with doing the stuff they don't usually get to do.
Right.
But the truth is they want to do that stuff for the store. So I think – so look, one shining example, right, the decade stuff for the 100th.
Yeah.
There was some stuff in that line that the baby Pegasus plush from Fantasia, oh, my God. Oliver and Company plush, some of those pins, a lot of stuff they did for that event. I was like – it's a shame you got stuck with some of it because a lot of this is very cool and creative.
Yeah.
But that's like the sad truth is maybe –
well, I mean,
maybe
they
it was too much for people.
You can't. Well, there was way too much merch in all of that, right? Like, you couldn't collect all of the decade stuff.
Yeah.
There was between the vault collection and the decades, they go overboard, right? Like, if
decades
they release
wasn't that bad, decades is like
Vault was a lot, but
five
Vault
items
sold.
For every decade or
Vault
something.
Sold, but yeah.
But decades they overproduced, and then there were some. Who was like, 2010s, Star Wars new trilogy backpack?
Well, what? I think the problem is they had the decades and the eras, and those kind of got people confused around the same time.
I mean, they also got different. Really stretched out, right? Yeah. Like the stuff was supposed to have a cadence, and then it got delayed and stretched out. And so then the decades and the eras overlapped because decade stuff
or
was
the
late.
Decades would show up in the parks incomplete.
Yeah.
So they're like, we don't have the pin, but we have the plush.
Right. And so I think that's a problem of execution.
Yeah.
The problem with that was the execution and the poor projection of sales.
Yeah.
Right. Like, I think what Disney needs to do is be better at projecting what sales are and then order enough stuff to meet that.
Yeah.
Right. Like the Figment. Lug backpack for Festival of the Arts is a perfect example.
Yeah.
That sold out the first day.
That might be Lug's problem, though.
Whoever problem it is, right? Like,
probably what they ordered. They probably ordered that from Lug. They're like, hey, we're going to need 500
usually,
of these, and we'll see how they do.
Usually they try to, like, not assume any...
any risk.
Right? So I think Lug, like, has the license, and they're like, you should do Figment for Festival of the Arts, and then they buy it. And then they, like, have a consignment deal, essentially. I think that's what happens. I think Dooney and the rest of them are all like that.
But regardless, there are things which I don't know who this is that thinks this way. But, you know, in Japan, if something sells out, everybody's happy, right? In the U.S., if something sells out, they're not happy. But if it sits around on the shelf for six, how long did Epcot 40th anniversary merchandise sit around?
Isn't it?
Yeah, there's still some of it around.
It's certainly at the outlets.
So, like either they way overproduced or they way screwed up the projection
there's
of sales.
There's never a sweet spot here. You know?
That's right. Yeah. There's never a sweet spot. Yeah. No one can figure out what the sweet spot is.
Yeah, so like the Walt the Dreamer statue was gone instantly.
Yeah.
The Walt the Dreamer ornament was even in Paramus.
Yeah.
Like, they're everywhere. They're available.
And I don't know. It seems like there's no person in consumer products with a holistic enough view of the consumer that's out there to make it work. And I don't think it's difficult. Yeah. It just takes somebody with some understanding of the product and understanding of the target market.
Yeah.
And no one has that.
Yeah. We haven't seen, right? It's been a long time since we've seen a product line with like that mass hysteria again, right? Like, we saw it a little bit with that Minnie Mouse, the main attraction. Then they did Mickey Mouse and they overproduced it, and people were like, I'm not in.
Because Minnie Mouse was such a pain.
Jake's going to hate this.
Stitch Crashes Disney was
Stitch,
a failure.
People bought that. Not as well. But then they're doing the Stitch Attack snacks, and I'm like, who wants this?
Nobody wants it.
Who's going to buy 12 Stitches where he's just holding a different food item?
But
they're not different otherwise.
I mean, think the dumbest one is Munchlings. I think that's...
Munchlings were a giant
mistake. Munchlings have been a failure.
Giant mistake.
But I think
Wishables were the last thing with legs.
They did Minnie Mouse Main Attraction, and they bungled it so much that then they're like, well, let's do Mickey. More people like Mickey will make more of it.
Yeah.
And people were so pissed off from the Minis, they're like, I'm not even going to do it. They screw up. And then they don't learn their lessons, and people are fed up with it.
I think you can cut them a little slack for the mini disasters because of supply chain issues.
Some of it was COVID, but early on they had a mess before COVID hit.
Yeah, it was not perfectly executed.
The Space Mountain launch was a mess already.
Yes. The Mickey stuff was...
But yeah, I think like Wishables and the very first Vault stuff, that was also pretty...
The Vault was great.
Yeah,
that was awesome.
I think the Eras stuff was great, and Tom said, there were some highlights in the Decades collection.
Yeah,
and those would have been, you know, I think that's kind of stuff that you'd like to see in a Disney store. That probably wouldn't have been there anyway.
Madam Mim and Merlin and Merlin. Yeah. Dragon and a mouse. They're fantastic.
I mean, I think the biggest problem with the Eras collection was that everyone thought it was Taylor Swift.
But let's look at Decades, right? Like, look, you know, shut up.
They would have bought it.
I think that's why they named it that. The Shaggy Dog. Why? Why did you make a plush of the Shaggy Dog and think you could produce the same number of plush of the Shaggy Dog as you did for Oliver and Dodger? obviously more people are going to buy Oliver and Dodger. No one knows who the Shaggy Dog is.
Even I barely know who the Shaggy Dog is.
And that's the problem. No, yeah. That's the problem is that you've got these pencil pushers that sit and be like, oh, well, for this plush, we ordered this many. We'll just order that many again. They have no idea across the board with the decades ordered the same amount of the target market or the demand.
There is a cross-section, though, that are people who are going to buy every release of the Decades collection, no matter what it is.
I just don't think that's the general public. I don't think anyone did.
No.
I don't think a single person owns everything in that collection. I have all the pins, but even the plush I didn't buy all of. I bought the Pegasus. I bought Merlin and Mim. I bought Oliver and Dodger. That might have been it. I might have bought those. Oh, and Three Little Pigs. I bought the Three Little Pigs. Because it's the Three Little Pigs. It's like, they don't make the Three Little Pigs ever. No. I have to buy this.
You know what they make in Japan that they don't make ever is the little oysters.
That is a phenomenon, the little oysters from Alice in Wonderland. I have so much little oysters merch.
Uh-huh.
They love them.
Yeah. But anyway.
Well, I'm curious what other people think about the Disney store, and they can tell us in the comments.
Yeah, for sure.
You know what you can buy, though? You could buy one of these snazzy shirts from Park Candy.
We're all wearing Park
Candy. And we don't match. We're all wearing different
Park Candy. I tried. Candy Eric keeps changing shirts right before recording.
Untrue.
I tried to match everybody.
You know, someone said in the comments that they think it's cute that we match. And I was like, that doesn't mean we should do it.
That's absolutely correct.
Oh, right? So Joe in the WIGS, I know I'm interrupting Ann. Joe has the Stitch eating popcorn. But Joe, are you going to buy the other 11? Are you going to have 12 of him in the same pose eating things?
Joe, instead what you should do is take that money and go to wdwnt.link/parkcandy. If you use the code WDWNT at checkout, you get 15% off. They have skirts, they have shirts, they have bags, they have bottle openers. They have all kinds of stuff.
I thought you were about to break into the Grinch. He took the Who's Banglers and the
But we do appreciate their support. We appreciate you supporting them, people who support us. So thank you very much in advance for that. Joe, I just took some of your money. I redirected it from foolish Stitch purchases to very high-quality shirts.
Stylish. Jake said he's getting all 12. Jake, are you actually getting all 12, or are you just trying to be a Stitch stan right now?
Jake is a Stitch stan.
But is he going to get all 12 of those? No, he is. He said yes.
He said yes.
Oh, boy.
I'd like to see.
There's one in every crowd.
Yeah.
But yeah, if you missed something in particular about the Disney store, please leave it in the comments. Maybe we'll get back to this one day, this topic, especially the pin stuff. I think that has legs. You guys could talk about pins for a very long time.
We could do an episode on pins, absolutely. Yeah.
Imagine if there was like a whole podcast that was just about pins. In fact, you could call it the Pincast. That would be amazing.
Hey, Jake, can we mute Jason's microphone now? I think he's done being our guest on this episode.
We used to, for those that don't know, way back in like 2009, I think we started, maybe 08 even, we used to do a podcast purely about Disney pins for a couple of years, which decent audience. Yeah. How dare you? That's so mean.
And if you want to listen,
all the artists came on the show. We had interviews with all the artists who make pins.
That's cool.
And all of the episodes
while they worked for Disney. Could you imagine being on such good terms with Disney that you could have their artists on?
All the episodes are available for WIGS at the $7 and up level archives.
Is that working?
Yes.
So you can go listen to them. There's some good interviews in there. Monty Maldivan's a great one. Monty now does stuff for Shop Disney. But Monty started at Disney Feature Animation Florida, worked on Mulan and a couple other films there. And then when they closed, moved over to Disney Design Group, which did pins and other merchandise. And so it's some of their backstories are really fascinating, how they got to that job. So,
yeah, check it out if you're a WIGS member. Jason will teach you how to get access.
Did you plug the link for WIGS yet? This episode?
Oh, if you want to be a WIGS, yeah. We talked about the WIGS. We teased at the beginning.
They get
the WIGS are watching live. They get all kinds of cool stuff. Discounts, Discord, obviously they're communicating with us. You want to be a WIGS member, you can go to wdwnt.com/Patreon or patreon.com/WDWNT. NT. We've made it easy for you. For as little as $2 a month, you can get all these perks. They're all outlined on the website. $7 and up, you get start getting post shows and access to us recording this nonsense. Childish BS, as Tom would call it.
Eric's never going to do a show with Jason and I again.
That's probably true. But I want to thank you for joining the only show that I'm going to do with Tom and Jason. And we will see you next time on the WDW News Today podcast.
We'll see you real soon.